It's not about me. It's not about you. It's not even about us. It's about legacy. It's about what we choose to leave behind for future generations. And that's why, for the next year, and for the first time since 1974, the best and brightest men and women of nations and corporations the world over will pool their resources, share their collective vision to leave behind a brighter future. It's not about us. Therefore, what I'm saying, if I'm saying anything, is welcome back.
The work of a single organization, the Syndicate. A rogue nation, trained to do what we do, imbued with a new sense of purpose.
The Syndicate, you say?
Yes, sir. That's what he calls it.
Hi, I'm Kim Fawn. I am the senior manager of Blizzard Esports, and I'm joined by a very special couple to Blizzard Entertainment and the StarCraft II team, John and Jenna Bain. Thank you so much for joining me.
Yeah, pleasure to be here.
So we are at the conclusion of BlizzCon, where the WCS Global Finals just took place, and the eve of the launch of Legacy of the Void. It's been a rare opportunity to have both of you here on the West Coast, so I want to take advantage of this time and have you guys sit with us so we can talk about your history with StarCraft. And I want to start with Jenna. Jenna, for those who are familiar with you and StarCraft, they know that you have a rich history in StarCraft II, and it started with being the team owner of Axiom Esports. Can you tell us how that started?
Sure. Initially, we had taken a Crank Protoss player from South Korea out to MLG Raleigh. And together, he and I sort of went back and forth about finding more opportunities for him, because at the time, he didn't have an esports team to support him. And, you know, we just kind of came together and decided that we really wanted to make kind of like a family type of team where everyone kind of depended on each other, everyone helped everyone. And
how did you identify that Crank was the player that you guys wanted to sponsor?
We actually found out about him on StarCraft Reddit. And someone had, I can't actually remember his name. I love this guy to death who actually let us know that that Crank needed support. Said, you know, hey, there's this great guy. He is amazing. He streams all the time. We watch all of his streams. And, you know, wouldn't it be great just to bring him out to a live StarCraft event in North America to see, for people to be able to see what he can do. And perhaps he might get picked up by a team that was already in existence. And
so from there, yeah. Axiom Esports was born.
That was it.
I know the community. You guys are such a huge part of the community, but to make the decision for a financial investment in an esports team, what were your reasons behind that?
Passion mostly.
That's so
we've
great.
We both really enjoyed watching Brood War back in the day, and even now StarCraft II, and it's you know, it's just always been a passion project for us.
So this question is going to go both of you. What were some of the unseen challenges? I imagine there are many owning a team. What were some of the things that you learned, challenges that you had to face that overcome?
I mean, there's a great deal of challenges in running an esports team, many of them being financial, as you might imagine. I don't think the sheer cost of it really it wasn't something that we really understood until we really got involved in it and started to go through. You can plan for this sort of thing, but you can never really plan for all of the eventualities and all sorts of hidden costs and things like that, and organizing, just being able to get players out of South Korea halfway across the world and make sure they do so safely, know where they're going, get to where they need to go, and they're properly accommodated and in the sort of right environment where they can play is actually extremely challenging. You know, it's a big logistical challenge. The other concern really is navigating an ever-changing scene, something that is going to be altered on a year-by-year basis, depending on the regulations and the rules. And of course, when WCS started, we needed to figure out exactly where our players were going to play and under what conditions. And over the years, of course, that changed. We were able to play in WCS for a while, and then they had to go back to Korea to play in GSL, which is quite a bit more challenging and was very difficult for them to do. But we wanted to make sure they still got to visit as many other countries as possible and get to play in front of their fans in different places. So that's expensive and certainly very time-consuming to sort out.
We're continuing our conversation about Gamergate, and I'm joined today by John Bain, known to many of you in the gaming community as Total Biscuit. He is a gaming commentator and critic on YouTube, also known as a video game broadcaster. So, John, I'd like to focus today a little bit more on these issues of journalistic ethics. But before getting into that specifically, I want to talk a little bit about a challenging area I've had in discussing the different harassment-related claims that are made by both sides. And the issue I'm running up against is whenever I ask anyone to address the allegations on their side of either harassment or sexism or misogyny, they very quickly say, listen, I don't know that those are really people that are part of Gamergate on our side. So how can we really get beyond that to have a substantive conversation about the issues of harassment?
Well, I genuinely believe that good faith is a great part of that, and that games media has to demonstrate a willingness to come to the table, at which point I believe that people will start to discuss it. The problem is that there is a big disagreement in how exactly to address online harassment. I fall into the camp that I do not believe publicizing it helps it go away. It's the age-old idea of feeding the trolls. I believe that the best way to deal with it is to starve it of oxygen. Over the course of my career in this particular field, I've received numerous death threats, some of which one would say were credible because they contained specific personal information. And I was advised never to publicize those because it would most likely result in either copycat behavior or simply giving far too much attention to the person that actually sent them in the first place.
Oh, I agree with you. And I made clear in my interview with Brianna Wu that when it comes to specific threats against me, that's been something I've done as well. But my question's a little bit of a different one, which is if we want to address or have a real conversation about whether one side or the other has elements of sexism, for example, we can't even really have that conversation, I find, or I've been unable to, because very quickly the individual I'm speaking to will say, if you've seen what appears to be sexism from our side, those weren't really people that are on our side.
It's the real problem with a leaderless hashtag movement that has zero entry requirements, doesn't it? And
yeah,
it's also a problem on the other side because those have claimed it is anti-Gamergate. But anti-Gamergate isn't really anything. Unless you are taking part in a hashtag like, say, Stop Gamergate 2014, which didn't go anywhere, then all you're really saying at that point is that there's some organized other side, and there clearly isn't. And more to the point, I would say that even Gamergate itself is not a side. There is so much disagreement within it.
No, and it seems that there are these two sides within Gamergate, right? The one that says the issue...
I'd say there are more than that,
frankly. Well, at least the two big narratives seem to be, and correct me if I'm wrong, Gamergate is about journalistic ethics, or Gamergate is about misogyny and racism within games.
I wouldn't say that those are the only facets of it. There are those that believe in the notion of social Marxism and the infiltration of progressive radical social justice ideas into gaming media and gaming journalism. And some people object to that. Some people do not object to it. There are people in it solely because they feel alienated by the games media that they trusted for so long. And that really boils down to the Gamers Are Dead articles that were released. There are people in it solely for that reason. And yes, I do believe there are some people, a minority, but some people that are in it to cause trouble. Now, whether or not they are trolls, whether or not they are actual misogynists that really believe that the presence of women in this industry is somehow a threat, it's very hard to quantify that. I think the only way to get past it is to focus on those that wish to discuss constructive issues and wish to make this industry better and freeze out those that do not.
I can just give you an example of one or two connections. First of all, the guy that's playing bass with us here tonight, we asked him to be in the band right at the beginning, because he's actually my cousin. He's a little bit, just a little bit older than me, and he came along to our first rehearsal and loaned us the gear for our very first rehearsal in Easter 1961, for God's sake. We went down to the rehearsal hall. He even showed our drummer, Hugh, how to play the very first sort of basic bass drum and snare drum with him, which, to be fair to Hugh, he picked up within about 4 seconds, and he was quite brilliant. It was a marvellous combination of things going on. But Jim was there right at the beginning, and then when the original Zombies, the first time round, broke up, then Colin almost immediately made a solo album, a beautiful album called 1 Year. Now, 1 Year had a single on it called Say You Don't Mind. Now, that was a Denny Lane song. It was a huge European hit, and it was done on this version with strings. Now, I produced that album. Jim played on it. I played on it. There was a real connection there. And another connection is that Say You Don't Mind, always in a rock and roll version, always used to be the finishing song way back in 64 and 65 for the Zombies. So connections all over the place. And here's one more connection. When Jim and I founded Argent, once we broke up with the Zombies, then the biggest hit that we ever had, most people presume that I wrote it. I didn't write it. It was written by Chris White, the original bass player with the Zombies, and we would love to do it for you now.
Oh, this is a picture.
No, this is a movie camera.
Oh, is it really?
A cinema. Yeah. This is a 4K cinema camera.
Bloody hell.
You're looking at 20 grand here. Okay, Jim.
Yeah, we, as Argent formed, we, Time of the Season in the States was number one hit. So we would play Time of the Season. Well, we were doing a big gig in Munich, Germany, where we had to play 9 sets through the night. We did this every night of the week, and it was a good way of getting the band up to speed. So we would play a very long version of Time of the Season. Then, so I would just change the riff a bit, and Bob would play slightly different drums. So we went doom 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 doom. Chris White, the bass player with the Zombies, was there. He, as a producer, he loved that riff, so he wrote Hold Your Head Up. Dum, 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 dum. So the bass riff comes out of Time of the Season. And that's often, Rod tells that story every night, so just interesting, isn't it, how things evolve from one thing to another.
Yeah, he mentioned it, Rod.
It's a great pleasure to have Neil Doc Simon here tonight. He's a good friend, and in the last 2 decades, he has turned out 18 Broadway shows, the nation's without a doubt leading comedic playwright. Would you welcome Neil Simon? See, I must explain, Neil thought he was doing the big show.
No.
Watch out.
I just got home from the Academy Awards. I mean, you wait so long for your car there. I'm going out. I'm going to play stickball on Rodeo Drive.
That's his uniform, isn't it?
Yes.
You couldn't see the number on
that. Yeah. I am going someplace.
Well.
I don't know where. Marshall will tell me later.
Yeah, Academy Awards, you were right. That ran a little long that night, didn't it?
Yes.
You came on. You did say something about you wanted to get your validation. You let the parking attendant know that you wanted to get your car early?
I didn't hear the entire show because I knew I was going up, and I was working feverishly for Lime. Who won?
Alan Splett did not show.
Alan Splett didn't show.
Alan Splett didn't show. It's good to see you. Are you working on a play right now, or are you always working on a...
Just finished last week. A new play. It is called The Curse of Kolyanchikov. Kolyanchikov. It doesn't exist. I made up the name. I may have to change it. It takes place in Russia. It's a farce. It takes place in 1890 in Russia. And you'll come and see it.
I certainly will. When's it going to start?
We're not doing it in Los Angeles this year. I've done four in a row, and we're going to do it in Boston this year.
Right. You have an absolutely incredible record at this, and once in a while you will hear critics, and I'm sure you've heard it, and I'll answer for you because you might be reluctant to do. People sometimes will say, Neil Simon, former sketch writer, former jokes, and it's nothing but a series of jokes stuck together, and it's really not a play, and they make it sound like it's just something you toss off. And the answer to those people who say that, and I've heard that from other writers, is sit down and try it.
Mm-hmm.
Sit down and try to do it. It is one tough task to sit down and write dialogue. It's not so difficult to write a joke. It's difficult to write dialogue and make it funny and make it believable.
Well, for me, the dialogue comes last. I think people get the image that I sit down and write a lot of jokes and then try to get into a play. I don't at all. I think of a story. I think of characters mostly. The dialogue comes last. The dialogue surprises me. I find myself laughing occasionally because I have no idea that it was coming.
You're sitting there and the character should say this and it flows.
Mm-hmm.
All of us who think we do comedy, hope we do comedy, are asked to be on a show to discuss it. Don't you find it's really a futile type of exercise?
It's the hardest thing.
There is nothing
in the world.
Duller. I remember I was on, David Susskind asked me to go on a show years ago and Woody Allen was just starting, just starting then. And all of a sudden when you discuss comedy, it becomes very deathly.
It's
become
totally
serious,
impossible.
And it's impossible really to describe what makes one person laugh and not another. It's all relative, and the discussion really goes nowhere.
Well, first of all, there's no way that you're going to get everybody
to agree.
Yes. If you did, you would never have a flop if there were a formula. There is no formula for it.
No.
I just hope that what I find funny, the rest of America would find funny.
You seem to have found that pretty good so far, I would think.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
What kind of a sketch do you have? Are you a morning writer? Are you one of those people who gets out and...
I'm not a night writer. No, yes. I like the mornings best. Take a break for lunch, play tennis, and then work in the afternoon. But I cannot work more than 4 hours a day. I find it is more enervating than five sets of tennis. I have literally felt I could feel the electricity coming out of my body because so much energy is... You have to draw upon so much.
Right.
And after 4 hours,
that's why I asked.
It
didn't sound like a sophomore question, because when you write sometimes, it's important. Some people can't write in the morning because their energy level is such that they work better at night or any other.
Except when you're on something that is so good, you can't wait for it. I mean, I rush into the office sometimes in the morning. I don't take off my jacket because in the car, on the way over, I said, oh, I've got to get to this. Other days, I pray that I have the wrong key to the office.
Yeah.
In the movies they used to make back in the 1950s, life was a teenage beach party. The biggest threat to public morals was a dance called The Twist. And there was a young actor named Tab Hunter who was every high school girl's idea of a dreamboat. He was a boy who never seemed to get any older. Well, he has.
I'm no longer in the public eye. I was really surprised when you all said we want to do something on you. I thought, why me? I'm appreciative. I thank you very much. But, I'm as popular out on the West Coast as yesterday's chopped liver. Come on.
They say for every boy and girl there's just...
It wasn't always that way. In 1956, over 1 million heartsick girls bought Tab Hutter's recording of the song Young Love. As an actor of the 1950s, he was a teenage heartthrob. Discovered while he was working in Los Angeles as a stable boy, Hutter's fresh-faced good looks caught on fast. By 1955, his fans had chosen him as Outstanding New Movie Personality. It all began in 1949 when a fatherless runaway named Arthur Jolene suddenly found himself with a Hollywood contract and a new identity.
I was so green, I couldn't read my new name off a piece of paper, you know, Tab Hutter. I didn't like it at first. I thought, what happens when you're older? And it says Tab, you expect someone to come waddling out in a pair of diapers. It just didn't sound right to me. I'm used to it now, of course.
Tab Hutter today is 45.
Morning.
He lives 3,000 miles from Hollywood in rural Virginia. This is horse country, and fox hunts are everyday events. Tab Hutter is at home here. In fact, the story goes that his movie name came from his working with hunters and jumpers at horse shows. Let's tab him Hutter, they said. Even before he was a movie star, he was a trophy-winning horseman.
When I was about 11 or 12, my brother took me out to his stable. Scared to death at first. And then I just became more in love with it all the time because I found that those days I couldn't communicate with people. I used to be really shy, you know. I go out to the barn and I spend all my time with my horses.
Hunter still likes to train and sell young horses. For the past 3 years, he's lived in a rented house overlooking the Shenandoah River with his secretary, John Donaldson. Acting is still what pays the bills.
I love working as an actor. I have to keep working. That's why I moved from California, because when I couldn't work there, I was not content to just sit by a swimming pool and read a script. Wake up tomorrow morning, you're 65 years old, and you're not doing anything. I went off to Europe, and I worked there. I did a lot of spaghetti westerns. I worked here and there. Worked in Italy, worked in Spain. And then I came back and did a little bit of television. And I work in dinner theaters. I'm one of the pioneers of dinner theaters. I've been doing them for 10, 12 years. I do them all over the country, and I love it. And you get these wonderful people that come on up and say, hey, you done real good. Slam you in the back. That's wonderful because it's simple and honest. I like that, you know, as opposed to, you know, pressuring people.
The pressures of the big Hollywood studios made Tab Hutter, and in the end, they brought him down.
When I was under contract, you know, a studio would tell you what they wanted you to do. After a while, I'd say, hey, wait a minute, that's not what I really feel. I started resenting being told what to do when I didn't feel that way. I sort of tried to break away from that mold. You want to be an individual. You want to be yourself. And how do you do this when you're getting all kinds of, when you're getting 2,500 or 1,500 letters a week and people wanting from you? You know, I don't think people are entitled to do that.
If Hunter got a call to come back to Hollywood, he says he'd take it. But he's not waiting for the phone to ring. He says he's learned that being a big name in Hollywood can't be taken too seriously.
My favorite thing happened in Florida. I was doing a play down there. This woman stepped in the elevator, and she looked at me, and then she did this double take, and she looked at me, and she went... I said, Troy Donahue, and she said, that's it! That's one of my favorites.
Welcome back. Well, he was the golden boy of Hollywood in the 1950s, but superstar Tab Hutter was leading a double life. In this candid chat with our very own Craig Bennett, Tab opens up about his secret life.
Follow my tracks and you will find broken hearts I've left behind.
It was his blonde, tan, surfer good looks, along with his talent, that shot Tab Hutter into the Superstar League as one of the hottest teen idols of the 1950s.
I think I've died and gone to heaven.
He was America's boy next door, and nothing, it seemed, could tarnish his stellar career.
Hello, I'm Tab Hutter, and I've got a secret.
It wasn't until his private life became a very public scandal that Tab was forced into the spotlight with a scorchingly candid memoir, Tab Hutter Confidential.
It's not my comfort zone, that's number one.
You know, when my friend Alan said, you know, I think you should do the book, I thought, oh, why would I want to do a book? And then he told me, well, so I hear someone else is going to be doing one on you. And I thought about it, and I thought, I don't know about that. Get it from the horse's mouth, not from some horse's ass, after I'm dead and gone. So I did the book.
I'm old enough to do anything.
Tab was Hollywood's ultimate golden boy. His first starring role, at just 19, was with Linda Darnell in the romantic South Seas adventure, Island of Desire.
Let me go, Mike. I'm all right now. Let me go.
Linda Darnell was an extraordinary woman. The first thing she said to me in our screen test, I was very nervous, and she said, relax, don't worry, I'm good luck for newcomers.
That role led Tab to star opposite some of Hollywood's leading silver screen sirens.
You got to kiss Sophia Loren.
The thing about Sophia was, under all that fire and sex that you saw portrayed, she was childlike. She had a simplicity that I really loved, and that's what made her so interesting, because under all of that, you had a softness.
You're the bravest man I've ever known.
Rita Hayworth, tell me about Rita.
There was something very sad about Rita. You just wanted to put your arms around her.
A vulnerability?
A vulnerability about Rita that was quite extraordinary.
You are my lucky...
Then there was the unsinkable Debbie Reynolds.
Debbie was a little tomboy when I knew her. She had just been out of the Burbank High School. She played the French horn. Warner Brothers put her under contract. They dropped her. Luckily, MGM picked her up and made her the big star. And that's about the time I met Debbie and knew her and took her out a lot. We saw a lot together. We went out a lot. She was wonderful.
You were so close to Natalie Wood. When she died, you must have been shocked.
Natalie never liked water. She never liked the water. And I remember when we were doing our film, a Western, I gave her a hand up on the back of the horse that we were riding through the river. And I could tell she was scared to death. And I said, Natalie, don't worry, it's going to be fine. But she always had a fear of the water. And my feeling is that when they were on that boat in Catalina, there was a dinghy that was hitting against the side. And it bothered her, the sound of that. She couldn't sleep, so she put a down coat on and went outside, slipped and fell into the water. And a down coat, when it gets full of water, gets very heavy. And that's what caused her death.
Young love, first love.
Tab went on to become a singing sensation, recording Young Love in 1957, knocking Elvis off the number one spot.
I always liked music. Natalie and I were in Chicago on a tour for a film of ours, and this big disc jockey heard me humming and singing, and he said, did you ever think of recording? And I said, no, I'd like to. And he said, well, let me talk to Randy Wood at Dot Records. I got back to California, Randy called me up, I came in. He said, if I hear of a good song, I'll let you know, because he heard me sing. He called me up, I recorded Young Love on a Friday. On Monday morning, I heard it on the car radio and almost hit a palm tree. I couldn't believe it. And then it went bing and became number one song in the nation.
These lips were made for kissing, these hips.
After a successful career in film, TV and music, Tab's career took off again in the 80s when he worked alongside drag queen Divine.
John Waters called me when I was doing a play in Indianapolis, and he said, my name is John Waters, and I don't know if you know me. I said, I'm a major fan of yours. Are you kidding? He said, well, I have a script I'd like to send to you, see if you'd consider doing it with Divine. And I said, Divine? Wow, that'd be terrific. And he said, but first, how would you feel about kissing a 350-pound transvestite? I said, well, I'm sure I've kissed a hell of a lot worse.
Shocking but true story of a young man who found himself overwhelmed by a strange compulsion.
Hello, I'm Tab Hunter, and I've got a secret.
Throughout his career, Tab kept his sexuality a secret, always in constant fear that if word got out he was gay, it could spell the end of his career.
I never confronted any of those things. I never confronted my sexuality. I never confronted those things. Anytime something seemed to disturb me, I would push it from my mind. I had that ability to do that because I didn't want to face a lot of that. If people got too close to me, whether it be knowing someone or whether it be something that was written about me or whatever, that filled me with a lot of angst because I was a very private person. My mother told my brother and I when we were growing up, nothing for show. Of course, I wind up in show business. No, but the thing is, I was very uncomfortable, and my touch of reality in that unrealistic world of Hollywood were the horses. I felt closest to God with a pitchfork full of crap in my hands.
You also reveal in your book that you were dating Anthony Perkins.
I met Tony Perkins at the Chateau Marmont. I'd been out to the barn riding in the morning, and I came back and just went by for a swim at the pool. And my friend Venetia Stevenson was there, and she introduced me to Tony. We became friends for, you know, a few years.
So many gals I haven't met.
Tab is now out and open about his sexuality and has been with his partner, film producer Alan Glazer, for over 30 years. But throughout his tumultuous career and brushes with ailing health, this golden boy of Hollywood still oozes charm and is grateful for his Tinseltown success.
I think the most important thing is to say thank you every day. And don't forget it.
Don't bother me. So many nights for having fun. So many fights I haven't won. There's not enough notches on my